In this Indian Tribe tour, we'll learn how network socket programming works in C on Linux. Source file link in the description. A network socket is just an endpoint in communication. It's not unlike a file descriptor. Network socket programming is all about getting hold of the descriptor so that we can perform operations on it, such as reading and writing. You'll need a client and a server. This episode is on a client. We'll take a look at the server in another episode. Say we're a client looking to connect to IPv4 address 127.0.0.1 at port 6969. Before we connect to the socket, we'll need to translate the address and port information to something that can be accepted by the connect function. There are a number of functions, but we'll use getaddrinfo, which is compatible with both IPv4 and IPv6, and is also re-entrant. To look up the information on this function in a manual on a Linux terminal, we use the most sexist command known to man. Man. Type man followed by the function name. On Linux machines with advanced gender studies degrees, the command woman also works. We can see that getaddrinfo wants a pointer to a char array for node, which is the destination IP address. It wants a pointer to a char array for the service type, which is the destination port number. It wants a pointer to a structure addrinfo, which contains the hints we can provide the function to help its translation. Finally, it wants a pointer to a pointer of a structure addrinfo, which is a linked list that contains all guessed results once the function is run. The double pointer notation might be confusing, but it is necessary for linked lists. The function returns integer 0 if it succeeds. Let's make a file called client C. To edit it, I'll use micro, but you can use your favorite text editor or IDE, or if you have copious amount of chest hair, use Vim. We'll include some header files. To see why those files are needed, take a look at my source code, link in the description. First, we create the main function. We print a simple message for debugging. Now let's define those inputs. IP address is 127.0.0.1, port number is 6969. We'll need an integer for the client socket handle. Hints for getaddrinfo must be in a struct addrinfo, so we create one and don't forget to zero its memory. We'll also need two other addrinfo structs, one as a pointer to the linked list to which the result of getaddrinfo outputs, the other as a pointer to one record within the results linked list. The hint struct contains a number of settings and we're going to specify a few of them. Since we're using IPv4, we tell it so, which is AF-INET. Then we tell it that we want to use the stream socket. Since TCP is not the only stream socket protocol, we also need to tell it that we want to use TCP. Now let's put those variables in a function. The first two arguments are straightforward. The third argument accepts a pointer, so we use the ampersand operator to get the struct's address. The last argument accepts a pointer to a pointer, and since earlier we declared results as a pointer itself, we also use an ampersand operator to get the results pointer's pointer address. We include some rudimentary exception handling and debugging message here. With address information translated, now we need to create the socket. To do this, we use the socket function. It wants an integer for domain, which specifies the address family such as IPv4 and IPv6. It wants an integer for type, which specifies the socket type such as stream or datagram. Lastly, it wants an integer for protocol, which specifies, well, the protocol such as TCP or UDP. The function returns a non-negative integer file descriptor if it succeeds, and integer -1 if it fails. Recall that getaddrinfo writes all its guesses to a linked list called results. This means results can contain more than one guess, and hopefully at least one of them can be accepted by socket. To try all guesses, we iterate through the linked list results. For the for loop, we initialize a record in the linked list. We test to see if the record is null, which happens if the list is empty or if the loop has reached the end of the list. Once the loop is run, we update the record to the next item in the linked list. Within each iteration of the loop, we feed the socket function the guess of the current results record and ask it to attempt to create the socket and assign the return value to integer variable client socket. If it fails, client socket will be assigned -1, in which case the program skips the rest of the loop, iterates to the next record, and tries again. If it succeeds, then we have a socket we can use to connect. To do this, we use connect. It wants an integer for the socket file descriptor. It wants a pointer to a struct socadder for address, which is the struct that contains the address. It wants a soclen t for address len, which is the length of socadder structure pointed by the previous argument. The function returns integer 0 if it succeeds. We already have the socket file descriptor returned by the socket function. The latter two arguments are conveniently contained in the struct addrinfo of the current record. If the connection is successful, we break out of the loop and move on. Otherwise, we close the socket and repeat the loop. At the end of the loop, we close the client socket. This can only happen if socket creation is successful, but connection isn't. If both socket creation and connection are successful, this line is never run. We include some rudimentary exception handling for when no guest for a getaddrinfo results a successful socket connection. Lastly, to prevent memory leak, we must remember to free the linked list results. We then write the debugging status message. Now we're ready to send data. Let's write a simple message here. To send data, we use send. It wants an integer for socket, which is the socket file descriptor to which data is sent. It wants a pointer to an array of void type, which is the data to send. It wants a size t for length, which specifies the size of the data to send. This is because the previous argument only specifies a pointer to the beginning of the data to send. Since it is of type void, the program relies on a size counter specified here to know when to stop sending. Lastly, it wants a flag, which we'll not use here. The function returns the number of bytes sent in type signed size t if it succeeds and -1 if it fails. We include some rudimentary exception handling debugging message here. Lastly, as the client, we must remember to close the socket as soon as we're done using it. Now we're done writing, we save the file and then compile it. As you can see, the compiled binary is now on desktop. To show how this works, I'll run it here. On the left side is the server program, which we'll see in another episode. On the right side is the client program we just wrote. And voila, message sent and received. Thanks for watching. I'd like to give special thanks to Heated Blankets, who did not sponsor this video. If you live in the north and have not experienced this magical device, you have not lived. This is an Indian tribe production, all rights very much reserved.